This is the Detroit Sports Podcast Network.
Today's episode of the Motor City Sports Rant is brought to you by Score, a new mobile app coming to you this August. Score is an interactive game that lets users win deals at bars and restaurants based on what's going on in live sporting events. Find new places to watch the game and save money on your bill at the same time by taking advantage of Score's unique interactive specials that give you an additional stake in the action. A Score special can be anything a location wants it to be, from 10% off an item if a team scores a touchdown to a free round of drinks if the quarterback throws for 400 yards. Any stat can be turned into a game. Pick the deals you want to win, watch the games you want to watch, and score deals in real time. The app will update when your teams or players record a relevant stat. When the conditions of your deals are met, coupons are sent to your device to show to your server or bartender. It's that easy. Score is coming to the App Store and Google Play this August. For more information, check them out on the web at score-app.io and follow them on Twitter and Instagram at Score Deals. Score. Watch games. Score deals.
Detroit is the greatest!
Straight up light you on fire for a Coney dog right now.
Throws, end zone, Calvin, touchdown, Detroit Lions!
What's up, Internet? It's another episode of the Motor City Sports Rant on the Detroit Sports Podcast Network. I am Jason Jarvie. Follow me on Twitter at JarvieTheKing. If you're wondering why this sounds like I'm on a phone, it is because I am on a phone. I'm on vacation. I'm taking my first vacation with my little boy, going up to the lake, and a splish splash around the water, maybe float on some inner tubes, have a couple pops, and just generally recharge the batteries. But I needed to chime in and give my take on the state of Detroit sports right now, because I couldn't just let John, the Doc Macaroon, I couldn't just let him talk for about 30 minutes and give his opinion, because I know he's going to give you just some skewed opinion about how the Tigers, they need to rebuild and he needs to, you know, just trade Justin Verlander and get everything you need back, because that's not what actually happens in baseball. I'm going to break it down as to how it's actually going to work out for the Detroit sports in general. I'm also going to chime in on the Lions. I'm going to give you my opinion on Matt Stafford going into camp, not having a contract, but the Lions still seem to be doling out contracts to other players before their franchise quarterback. But let's start with the Tigers. As of this recording, we're about an hour and a half away from the Major League Baseball trade deadline. Already we saw earlier this morning that Justin Wilson, Alex Avila, got traded to the Chicago Cubs for two pretty top-tier minor league prospects. You know, they end up on Detroit's minor league system, they end up being the number 3 and 8 prospects and giving them a total of 4 in the top 100 of all of baseball. So you could probably say that they could have gotten more, but I think what's going to play out is you're going to actually get a better quality of players in these two prospects than you might have gotten from 3 different prospects from another team. It is a little strange that they aren't trying to go get, you know, rotation arms in prospects, and instead they loaded up on positions that they seemingly already have filled with shortstop and third base. But, you know, time will tell. You know, Nick Castellanos might be able to fill a role in the outfield. Who knows how long Miggy's going to be at first base. I think in a year or two he's going to be DHing for us anyways. So I think it'll be interesting. We'll just have to see how it plays out. You know, the Tigers also just recalled Joe Jimenez to probably replace Justin Wilson, and we're going to see in these next couple outings just how good he can actually be. He's been pretty solid down in Toledo so far. But then the two big people that you would have thought might have been on the trade block. Justin Verlander, Ian Kinsler, more than likely they're not going to be moved. And obviously, this is coming out the day after the trade deadline. So if I'm wrong, I sound like a big dummy, but I'm just going to say it. You know, Justin Verlander, Ian Kinsler, Justin Upton, probably not going to be moved. The earliest you're going to see those guys go anywhere is going to be in the winter, and that's if they even move. And the asking price was probably just too high, and realistically, there wasn't going to be any good that came from getting Justin or from trading away Justin Verlander. I think if you would have made those deals earlier, like the ones that the White Sox made, trading away Jose Quintana, you might have been able to get a better deal there. You're probably just not going to get the caliber of player or prospect that you want to get back from a Justin Verlander type player. So that leads us going into the rest of the season, really unsure of what the Tigers are going to do. And my suspect, I've been saying all along, is that after the trade deadline come August 1st, that Brad Ausmus and Al Avila will be fired from the Tigers organization. But I'm going to change that stance. If they are not fired by tomorrow, August 1st, then we're probably going to be looking at Al Avila and Brad Ausmus running this team for the foreseeable future, because if they haven't changed yet, then why bother change at this point anyways? Just keep the status quo. If this team is going to be on a couple years run of just being down in the cellars of the Major League Baseball, then why bother trying to go out and, at least on the manager position, why bother trying to go out and find that next guy? What you want to do is you want to actually try and build up this roster and build up this farm system to where it's a true rebuild. And I think we're still unsure if Alex really is the manager. You know, Dave Dombrowski did have a little bit more time. People, I think, forget that when he came in, he was part of the team when they went. They had one of the worst records in baseball history in 2003. And then he started getting players, and he started turning the team around. So in year two of Al Avila, you know, we do see some moves. We definitely see all the trades and the signings that didn't work. But I think it's going to be a wait and tell. I think they should be fired tomorrow. If that was me, if you're talking to me, you fire them tomorrow. But more than likely, if they stay past tomorrow, they're going to stay the rest of the season. And you're probably going to be seeing them in the next year. Which I know John is listening to this as I'm talking about this, because I know he can hear me on the phone, and I know he's just cringing, and he's probably going to come on after me, and he's going to just rip to shred everything I said, but I came out and said it. Well, if they are not gone, Avila, Ausmus, we're going to be seeing them next year, all next year. Now let's dive into some lines. Training camp started, and there's already a bunch of injuries. Eric Ebron tweaked a hamstring. Ziggy Ansah tweaked something. We have pretty much nobody on the defensive line playing, or they're suspended. So there's all kind of issues already with the Lions. So why is there any hope for this team? And that hope is Matt Stafford. I said it last week. I said Stafford is worth at least 8 wins on this team. And he's going into the season without a contract. So he's playing for himself. He's going to be playing to prove and trying to earn that big contract. Because clearly he came into the offseason and he wanted to be paid as one of the top quarterbacks around. You know, we saw what Derek Carr got. He wanted to get paid probably way more than Derek Carr. So he's betting on himself this next season that if he can go out and, you know, get some success, it's either going to mean that he's going to be on his way out. He's going to sign with somebody else. Somebody else is going to pay him a ton of money, or the Lions will come to their senses, sign him again, or if we see you have another mediocre season, another so-so season where we see flashes of greatness, we might see Matt Stafford get franchised next year. And really, I don't think the Lions or Matt Stafford would really be too upset in that scenario, because already Stafford is getting paid a ton of money this year. If he gets franchised, he's going to get a ton of guaranteed money the year after that, which is really what he wants. You know, and if he gets franchised twice or 2 years in a row, kind of like Kirk Cousins has in Washington, then he's actually going to be getting paid more than, I think he's going to be actually getting paid more than Derek Carr at this point in guaranteed money. So it's a tricky scenario all around for the Detroit Lions. You know, I am happy that Glover Quinn got his contract. You know, he's an older player, but he's definitely one of the key parts of the defense. If we are going to have any success, it's going to rely on part, you know, Glover Quinn solidifying that defensive backfield. The biggest concern, obviously, going into the offseason was the defensive line, though. With Ziggy, you had Ziggy Ansah coming off injury, but he wasn't the big main concern. It was really the pass rush. I think we had the 30th worst pass rush in the league last year, and we didn't really add too much to it. You had Ziggy Ansah. You have Kerry Hyder, who's the breakout guy from last year, who kind of tapered off towards the end of the season. So you're hoping that he can get a little bit more consistency in the season. And then really it's a whole lot of question marks. And now you couple that with guys like Armonte Bryant and Cornelius Washington, both being suspended for games in the beginning of the season, and where the Lions are now in a position where they have to decide, do we give these guys reps in the training camp? Do we let them get accustomed to when they're not even going to be there for the first 4 or 6 games? So it's really early in training camp. We haven't lost anybody long-term aside from Taylor Decker. But, you know, people are, their reports are that his recovery is going well. He's out of the swing. But there's still no reports on when he's coming back. No other major injuries as of yet, knock on wood, for the Detroit Lions. I'm still in wait-and-see mode to see what actually happens and what this team is going to be in this season. And we're probably not going to really know what they're going to be come until week one of the regular season. So that's all I got for right now. I'm going to send it back to John, and he's probably going to, you know, just tear everything apart. Like I said, John hates me, but I know he loves me calling in and making a fool of myself talking about the Detroit Lions and the Detroit Tigers. But you guys all have a great week. I'm going to enjoy my vacation. Take it away, John.
Thanks, Jason. Always enjoy listening. So everyone's wondering, okay, why did he call in and why wasn't there any interaction? So I'm a guy that has 2 iPhones, and the situation is one is for work and one is for, you know, messaging and taking videos with the family. And I've been lucky in that I don't have any cases for either phone. I got the iPhone 7 Plus and I got the iPhone 6 regular. And everyone's been like, how have you avoided breaking your iPhone, not dropping it, not, you know, losing it without a case? And I've said, look, the cases are not cheap. You look around and you see how much they are. They're in the neighborhood of $30 to $40. And I'm like, you know what? There hasn't been a case that has come out that has made me want to go buy one. But unfortunately, with the iPhone that I used to record the podcast, I dropped the phone. And the damage that was caused was nothing with the phone, didn't shatter or nothing. There's no real breaks like you see with everybody and their phones. What happened was the part where the adapter where you put in your headphones is broke and it doesn't work. So I was able to plug it into the mixer for the podcast. I could hear Jason. I could hear all the music, everything like that. But the part that I needed was the part where I could talk to Jason and send the signal through. So it was my fault that Jason and I couldn't interact. But hey, with podcast, you can make it happen. And so Jason was able to give me his thoughts regarding the Tigers and Lions, and I will respond accordingly, no doubt about it. And I was telling myself, how much time should Jason get? Should I tell him to do 10 minutes, 15 minutes? I said, look, you went on vacation, have a good time, just spit me a little bit of your thoughts regarding the Tigers and Lions, and I can respond after, because I feel like, you know, when I was talking to Adam in terms of doing a podcast by yourself, I said, yeah, it's difficult, but at the same time, if you got a lot to say, then you just turn on the microphone and see what happens. So I'll own the responsibility for the part where I couldn't interact with Jason, but I greatly appreciate his little bit there regarding his thoughts about the Tigers trade, the Lions opening up training camp. Dude deserves a vacation with all the work that he's doing for the podcast and for 105.1, a great producer. Always enjoy talking to Jason. I'll catch up with him next week. So at the time of this recording, as Jason had said, the Tigers have about 1 hour left in the trade deadline. I don't think at the time of this recording that any other moves are going to be made than the moves that we have seen, with the moves of JD Martinez, Alex Avila, and Justin Wilson being traded from the Detroit Tigers. So I think this is what we got, and now we're left to sit here and evaluate how did Al Avila do in terms of his efforts to retool the Detroit Tigers. And you sit here and you look at the news with the Tigers trading Alex Avila and Justin Wilson, and you look at the return that they got, and you go, wow. Couple that with the acquisitions of infielders that they got in the JD Martinez trade, and you realize, okay, it's obvious and quite obvious that they're trying to restockpile and gain depth in the infield. And to start with that, I say, okay, I can understand that. I can understand that as an organization, when you look at it, you say there's a plethora of pitchers in the minors and several that can come up in the next few seasons to contribute for the Detroit Tigers. But then you look at the infielders that they received and you start to piece together, okay, what is their level of contribution going to be in the next 5 years? And everybody that says, well, you got to wait and see, it's absolutely right. But we still got to give an opinion on it. And the way you want to start to conceptualize it is, did the Tigers greatly improve their team for the future? They made an attempt, and we're going to have to wait and see if Al Avila did pick apart, did pick two or three, or maybe even four guys that can contribute. Step one, we definitely realize that the organization is not happy with Nicholas Castellanos and his defense at third base. And everyone, I guess myself included, is a little bit surprised that he regressed. I didn't think he would get that much better from last season, but in terms of how he's performed at third base, his defense has been basically atrocious, and everyone sees it, and it's forced Al Avila to kind of look at it and say, we got to go out, and we got to replace a bunch of infield positions, and the Detroit Tigers have made moves. And so once the moves were made, I looked at it, and I said, okay, it's not too bad. I'm not disappointed. Those that are prospect experts have looked at it and said, the return that they got is okay for Justin Wilson and Alex Avila. But as I sit here and I go, if the market was different, could the Detroit Tigers have gotten more? I kind of feel like, you know what? Would these moves have been available had he waited till 4 o'clock? Had he really rolled the dice and said, I'm not going to trade any of these guys up until the trade deadline. I'm going to push it all the way. I wonder if he could have got a little bit more. You know, I understand many people go by the Major League Baseball rankings in the top 100, and the Tigers got four top 100 players. You say to yourself, okay, these are guys now that we got to wait on to develop here in Detroit, and can they come up and can they contribute? Well, one of the first glaring things that people are looking at in terms of all the guys that they got are none of these guys project to have great power across their career based upon what they've shown in the minor leagues. And you say to yourself, ooh, you're going to have a third baseman that doesn't really perform day to day and isn't able to bang the home run? Because that's where I think Major League Baseball is going from what I see. You got to hit the home run. You got to be able to have power, especially at first base, third base. And the prospects that the Tigers have acquired haven't shown a consistency in terms of having a big bat. But the advantages are right now is that it's very early. It's still early in their careers. Candelario is 23 years old, and he's the guy that most people believe is the most Major League Baseball-ready talent, and he might come up as soon as next year to try and take the place of Nicholas Castellanos, who many believe either will be not here or will be transitioned over to first base. Many people are thrilled with Isaac Paredes, 5'11", 175 pounds, and they think that maybe, just maybe, he just may be the steal and maybe the top prospect that may come out of all of these moves. But everyone has kind of noted that Candelario was the Cubs' number one prospect, but that's not where he started. You got to remember, the Cubs made a massive move in terms of acquiring Jose Quintana, and they shipped over a ton of prospects. And so Candelario kind of moved up to number one in the Cubs organization, but that's not where he started. So you just have to ask yourself, and you can have this debate, and we'll definitely take all the thoughts that you have on our Twitter page at Detroit Podcast. You have to go out and ask yourself, do you think Al Avila did the proper job in terms of going out there and getting the proper return? And if you ask me, I'm definitely in the camp of thinking they could have gotten more had they maybe waited till the exact end of the trade deadline. Because once you look at what was reported, you see that there's at least a couple teams that might have been interested in Justin Wilson. And so that's all you need is a couple teams throwing out offers. You could have waited until the trade deadline potentially to make the move and maybe even maximize some ready talent. Because I understand there are teams that have said that there's prospects that they were definitely not going to let go of. But then I say, if they really wanted Justin Wilson, would they be willing to maybe throw in a ready player now? Would they be willing to throw in somebody else or additional prospects that could be of use to the Detroit Tigers? The first move that was made in terms of trading JD Martinez was universally panned. I understand that you got Lugo and he's the centerpiece and he could be a guy that could be an everyday player. And now you got two additional prospects for the move that was made on Monday. But let's just say, and you look at it without optimism, let's say you're a little bit skeptical. Let's say these guys don't pan out. Now you've gutted your system. You've gutted the Detroit Tigers without much in return. You got a situation where you got JD Martinez, who has just gone over to Arizona and blasted the hell out of the baseball. You look at Justin Wilson, a guy that you had under control for another season. You look at the situation with Justin Verlander, and the reports early on Monday were that the Tigers are going to hold on to him and maybe look into trade options over the winter or next season. You could have did the same thing with Justin Wilson. If you want to play devil's advocate, you know what? If the market's not good, why are you beholding on making a trade right away? Did you want to satisfy the fans? Did you want to satisfy a bunch of podcasters who are yelling and screaming that moves got to be made? I understand if you want to come out and say that the market was not good for these athletes, but if the market was not good, then maybe potentially with Justin Wilson, you maybe wait until the market changes. Maybe you wait until next season because you do have him under control, and maybe you could get even more should the market turn around. And so that's the kind of debate that people are having is, did the Tigers get enough? And it's being debated. Whether or not these athletes that Alavila went out and got, are they going to pan out? You got to be patient. But those that quickly come out and say you can't comment on it, it's really tough because you have opinions. You think, well, they're highly ranked. They're okay. They have a potential to improve the ball club. But when you're crazy about the Tigers and you want them to do as best as they can, you definitely have to weigh in on it because it's an exciting time. We all want to see and weigh in on what we think the Tigers are doing. Is Alavila getting the most out of the talent that he has? And so far, at best, it's debatable. Now, I know those that look at prospects will say, at least he didn't get fleeced by letting go of Justin Wilson and Alex Avila. But at the same time, if you ask the question, could he have gotten more? I think many people will say there's a chance that had things played out differently, then maybe we could have gotten a different haul. And the part that's in my mind that I can't shake, and many people will say you're being a little too skeptical, a little too critical, but it's a thought that I have, and I think many others have it, is that if Dave Dombrowski was back here and he was running the teardown, would we have gotten somebody different? Would we have gotten better, you know, would we have gotten a better haul back in return? And I can't help but shake the feeling that a different general manager with maybe more experience and a little bit more respect across the league, he could have possibly gotten a lot more than Al Avila did. And to bring up a point that Jason brought up, it's probably very likely that Al Avila and Brad Ausmus could return because you don't want instability across the organization ahead of maybe a sale. So it does frustrate me that the status quo in terms of upper management could take place because it's difficult to see now. It's difficult to assess if Al Avila is the right guy for the job, but just judging by the moves that he's made that haven't turned out, he definitely has cost the Tigers a bunch of money. And I still have yet to see what value Brad Ausmus brings to the table. So while I could agree with Jason, you're absolutely right, I'm not going to be happy about it. And I think it's reflected in the attendance that a lot of fans are not happy with the direction of the club. A lot of fans are not happy with Brad Ausmus, Al Avila, and the way things are going. Attendance is way down, and it hasn't been like this in a number of seasons. So everyone's at this point in time, you know, taking a wait and see approach, and they're looking at, okay, what's going to happen after the trade deadline? What's going to happen with management? What is the direction of the organization? And people are seriously looking at it. And so I'm invested. I still care. I hope Al Avila turns it around, gets a bunch of guys that do produce. But at this point in time, there is a large level of skepticism regarding the return that he got. But at the same time, you at least look at it and say, okay, there is at least a chance that a couple of these guys could hit and improve. But going forward, there will be a lot of talk and a lot of speculation about what's going to happen. And unfortunately for these guys, there is a little bit of pressure that these prospects are going to have when they come up because they were acquired by letting go of guys that a lot of fans in Detroit thought, wow, Justin Wilson's finally a productive bullpen reliever. You know, JD Martinez, unsung hero, because he was basically pushed aside in Houston, and he comes here and makes a career coming to Detroit and playing really well. So a lot of fans took to him. So it's one of those things where I hope, and I'm really, really, really bearing down and hoping that El Avila and the scouting staff did their homework, but there is a lot of skepticism, because if you ask the question, when's the last time a prospect or a guy that was developed by the Detroit Tigers just came up and was really productive day in and day out, and you look at it and you go, it's not a whole long laundry list of guys that you can list. Now, I just want to say a quick word before I give my final thoughts about the line starting training camp. I just want to say a quick word for our host site, Podomatic. Adam and I started this project in 2013, and we've only used one host site, and that's Podomatic. When we record all of our podcasts, we upload it quickly to Podomatic, generate links so that all of our supporters can find it. If you're going to start a brand new project, a brand new podcast, and there's one started basically every single day in town, and it's nice to see, we recommend one host site, Podomatic.com. Everyone's excited. Everyone's thrilled that the Lions have returned, and Jason addressed it while he was on vacation. It's great to see. Everyone is excited. And throughout this week on our network, DetroitSportsPodcast.com, we'll start the process of delving into what's going on with the Lions. Everyone's excited. There's a lot of storylines already. Basically, football is 24/7, 365 days a year. You can get a lot of things that you can talk about. You can delve in and look at the Lions, their roster, the moves that they've made, some contract negotiations that haven't been signed. So, like everybody else, I'm super excited. I'm excited to see what's going to happen throughout the course of training camp. And pay attention on our network. Visit our website, DetroitSportsPodcast.com, throughout the course of this week. And we'll definitely break it down, have some lively debates, and give our opinions about what we think about the Detroit Lions. But at the same time, my initial thought, I am definitely somebody that's taking the wait-and-see approach with the Detroit Lions. I'm a pragmatic Lions fan, sometimes bordering on crazy because of the fact that the past has affected me. It sticks with me. It lingers. And when others will say, hey, why would you invest in the Lions? What have they given you? I'm still a diehard Lions fan. I hope at some point in time, I hope they come back and are able to sustain the success that they started in 2016. And it's all going to be predicated on Matthew Stafford, the offensive line, the defense, how the running game works, how the running game is going to evolve. Can the Lions stay healthy? Can they avoid any further injury like they did to Taylor Decker? You hear early stories about the injuries to Ziggy Ansah, early injury to Eric Ebron. You just hope that the Lions can stay healthy, and you hope that you see progression in the players that have been here. And by all accounts, from what you've seen, you know, when the era was terrible back in the early 2000s, it just seemed like players would come to the Lions and they would come to die. Players' careers would just plateau and they would fall off the face of the earth. They'd come here and they wouldn't produce. It seems like under Jim Caldwell, the thing that you do see is you do see some progression in these players. You do see them performing a little bit better. Are they good enough to compete with the best in the NFL? Obviously not, but you do see a sense of improvement, and you do see an organization that is led by Bob Quinn that has a vision and it's being executed. Whether it will turn out to result in sustained playoff success, that's yet to be seen. But at this point in time, it's nice to say it's at least it's not garbage. At least it's not horrid. In years past, you would look at draft strategies, you look at acquisitions in free agency, and you go, this just isn't going to work. And so at this point in time, it's nice to have a little bit of hope. And that's what training camp is all about, is to see the team, the new roster that has been assembled by Bob Quinn. You want to see players that you are a fan of succeed and progress throughout the early parts of training camp. And at this point in time, it signifies that football is back. And that's all we can ask for. I look forward to sharing my thoughts with the other co-hosts on the network throughout the week. And you can message us anytime. Share your thoughts 24/7, any hour of the day on our Twitter page at Detroit Podcast. And you can download the other podcast 24/7 on demand, Detroit Sports Podcast. .com. Thank you for listening to this abbreviated edition of the podcast. Again, it's my fault. I forgot the important adapter that would have allowed me to talk to Jason, and we could have had some banter. But you know what? things happen for a reason. And if Jason's truly on vacation, having a good old time, then why the hell would he want to interrupt his day talking to a fool like me? I hope Jason enjoys his vacation. I look forward to recapping it with him next week. I'll try my best not to mess up and bring all the gadgets needed to record a great podcast. Thanks to everybody who downloads. Thanks to all the supporters and sponsors and contributors. It means a lot to us. See everybody next time.
Okay, nice, idiot. You. Bye-bye.
Good day, sir. I said good day.
All right. Take care now. Bye bye then.
Loser.